Hello everyone. The topic is temporomandibular joint imaging techniques from oral radiology. So now what is the introduction to this TMJ? Now this TMJ, it is a very complex joint and it connects the mandible and the cranium to form a craniomandibular articulation. Now already we have seen about the anatomy of TMJ during our first years itself. So it is a joint that connects the mandible to the cranium. So this is a joint between the condylar head of the mandible. So this is your condylar head of the mandible and it joins the mandibular fossa of the temporal bone. So this is like it forms that craniomandibular articulation. Now this TMJ or the jaw joint, it is a biarthrodial hinge joint that allows the complex movement which are necessary for life. Now we know the maxilla, it is a fixed bone. So because of this TMJ only, now you can perform various, like you can open the So you can perform those various functions like of opening the mouth, chewing, mastication, then speaking, and all these functions, they are possible just because of this TMJ. So the dysfunction of this TMJ can cause severe pain and lifestyle limitation. Now if there's a problem which is related to this TMJ, so it can lead to severe pain in front of your ear and there will be many limitations because now if there's pain over here, so the patient, they cannot speak properly, they cannot open their mouth, they cannot bite, they cannot chew. So because of that, there will be lifestyle limitation. So there are many pathologies which are associated with TMJ. And because of that, for this, you need proper diagnosis and treatment planning. Now this, like imaging, it is a part of your diagnosis. Because through this imaging, through this various imaging techniques, you can diagnose whatever the problem is associated with that TMJ. So the superimposition of the structure is usually seen in the TMJ imaging. So you'll see that now this is a very complex joint and there are many structures which will superimpose when you take the images of this TMJ. So what you have to do in this TMJ imaging is that you have to maintain the proper position in such cases. Now, which are the various radiographic techniques that you can do for temporomandibular joint? So the first one is transcranial, then transpharyngeal, transorbital. Now, these three, they are mainly confined to TMJ itself. Then the next one can be reverse tones, ultrasonography, OPG, then TMJ, arthrography, arthroscopy, CT scan, MRI, and bone scintigraphy. So these are like the various radiographic techniques that you can do for TMJ. Now this is again a very commonly asked SAQ in which they'll ask you that you have to just enumerate the techniques that you can do for TMJ. So this is like the complete answer to it, like what you need to write if it is just asked as enumerate the names. So starting off with the first one, that is the transcranial view. Now this is one of the most popular imaging technique to study the TMJ. So what are the indications of it? So it can be used in TMJ pain dysfunction syndrome, or it can be indicated in internal derangement, or if you want to see if there is any problem which is related to the movements in the joint. So you can take the transcranial view to see all this problem. Now how are you going to place the film in this transcranial view? So it is placed flat against the patient here. Now over here this is your film. So it is placed flat against the patient here and it is centered over the TMJ of interest. Now for example, if you want to see the problem which is related to left side of your TMJ, so you are going to place the film on the left side itself. And it is placed against the facial skin, which is parallel to the sagittal plane. So this is your mid-sagittal plane. So you'll see that this film, it should be parallel to the sagittal plane. Now, how is the position of the patient? Now, in this, the head, it is adjusted so that the sagittal plane is vertical. Again, your sagittal plane, it should be vertical. And the allotragus line, it should be parallel to the floor. Now, the line which is passing from the ala of the nose to the tragus of the ear, it should be parallel to the floor. So this is how the position of the patient is. Now this transcranial view, it can be viewed in three positions, that can be open, close, or it can be rest mouth. Now this is the difference in the open and the close. So this is how it looks when you are taking the transcranial view in the closed position, and this is the one with the open position. Now you can see this is your TMJ, so this is your condylar head. So the difference now you can see in the open and close. Now, how are you going to project the central rays? So now in this transcranial view, there are three techniques of projecting the central rays. So first one is a post-auricular, or it is known as Lindblom. The next one can be a Greek walk, and third one can be a Gilt approach. Now this post-auricular is the most commonly used one. So in this, what you do is, now how are you going to place your X-ray tube head? So this X-ray tube head, it is placed 1/2 inch behind and 2 inch above the external auditory meatus. So this is how you're going to place your X-ray tube head. So how you are going to project your central ray through this X-ray tube head. So now in this, it should be 1/2 inch behind and 2 inch above the external auditory meatus in this first approach. Now in the Greek walk, you'll see that the central ray, it passes through a point which is 2 inch above the external auditory meatus. So this is like, you're not going to place it behind or anterior, you're just going to place it on your external auditory meatus, and it should be just 2 inch above it. And the Gilt's approach is, it is 1/2 inch anterior and 2 inch above the external auditory meatus. So basically in all the three techniques, you are going to place it 2 inch above the external auditory meatus. The only difference is, you're going to place it on, behind, or anterior to it. So in the first, you're going to place it behind. Then in third one, you're going to place it anterior, that is in front of your external auditory meatus. Now in this, the X-ray tube head, it is brought into position on the contralateral side of the skull, so that the central beam, it is projected downwards 25 degree and it is centered on the TMJ. Now what are you going to do in this? Now we have seen that we are going to place the film on the same side of your TMJ nucleus, but now in this, the X-ray tube, it is placed opposite to it. Now if your left side is of interest, so in this, you're going to place your X-ray tube on the right side. So this is how the difference goes for your X-ray tube and the film. Now in this, you're going to place your X-ray tube head such that it is making a 25 degree angle downwards. Now in this, now we have seen there are two positions in which you can take this transcranial, that is closed and open. So in this closed view, what you can see is the size of the joint space, the position of the head of the condyle, the shape and the conditions of the glenoid fossa and the articular eminence. And when you're taking the open view, so you can see the range and the type of movement. So this is what you can see in open and close. Now what is the disadvantage of this transcranial view? So the major disadvantage that you will see is, there is superimposition of the petrous ridge over the condylar neck. So this is how it looks. So there is superimposition of this condylar neck with the petrous ridge. So this is the main disadvantage. So this is all about the transcranial view. So this is basically how you're going to take this transcranial view. Now the next one is the transpharyngeal view. Now this transpharyngeal view, it is also known as infracranial lateral sigmoid or McQueen's projection. So now what are the indications of this transpharyngeal view? So again, it can be indicated in TMJ pain dysfunction syndrome. Then it can also be indicated in osteoarthritis and rheumatoid arthritis. And if you see if there is any pathology which is related to the condylar head, like cyst and tumor, so in that case you can take this transpharyngeal view. Or if you see there is fracture of the TMJ, so again you can take this transpharyngeal view. Now how are you going to place the film? So in this, basically it is same like your transcranial, that the film, so the patient, they are asked to hold the film and it is placed against the ear and it is centered over the TMJ of interest. So this is basically the same. So you'll see the major difference is in the projection of your X-ray tube head, like how are you going to project your X-ray tube head. So in this, again, the position of the patient is like the occlusal plane. It should be parallel to the transverse axis of the film. And the patient, they are instructed to inhale slowly through the nose so that they're filling the nasopharynx with air. Now, when you take this transpharyngeal, so this is in which you ask the patient to inhale slowly so that you are filling the nasopharynx with air. Now in this open mouth, what you do is the condyles, they move away from the base of the skull, and because of that, the mandibular notch, that is your sigmoid notch, it is enlarged. Now how are you going to project the central rays? Now in this, it is again directed from the opposite side and it is making an angle that is 5 to 10 degrees, and it is like beneath the zygomatic arch. So the only difference now we have seen in the transcranial and transpharyngeal is how you're going to project this central ray. Now it is just in the angulation. So over there it was 25 degrees. Now over here this is 5 to 10 degrees. So now how is the projection of this central ray? So it is beneath the zygomatic arch. It is through the sigmoid notch, and because of that it is known as also known as lateral sigmoid, and it is posteriorly across the pharynx at the condyle. So basically what you do is it should be below the zygomatic arch through the sigmoid and directly it should go to your TMJ of interest, and this is how you take your transpharyngeal view. So this is how it looks. So this is the picture of the transpharyngeal view. So this is how it looks. Now there's a modification to this transpharyngeal view that is known as Parma modification. So now this in Parma modification, when the dental radiographic machine is used to produce this view, the lead lined cone or the cylinder which is used to aim the primary beam, it is removed from the machine. Now we know we have that lead cylinder which is placed inside your X-ray tube head. So what you do is you remove it in this Parma modification. So what you do is you are allowing the port of the tube head to be brought closed against the skin. Now when you remove a layer from your X-ray tube head to the skin, so now when you remove one layer, so what you're doing is you're bringing that X-ray tube head close to the skin surface of the patient's head. Now what is the rationale for this? So it is to establish a relatively short focal spot film distance. Now this is basically opposite to what we have seen in projection geometry. So why we are doing this? So we are like relatively making the focal spot film distance short so that it causes gross magnification of the tube side bony structure, so that you are obscuring the resultant radiograph. Now why you do this? So that you're reducing the superimposition of the structure. Now this is the main disadvantage of the TMJ imaging, that you'll see that superimposition of structure. So to overcome that, what you do is you magnify the image. And why, like how are you magnifying this image? So you're magnifying the image by removing that lead cylinder from the X-ray tube itself. So this is the Parma modification to the transpharyngeal view. Now the third one is the transorbital view. So in this transorbital view, this is also called as Zimmer or transmaxillary projection, and the indication for it is trauma fracture cases. So this projection is successful in delineating the joint with minimum superimposition. Now we have seen in the other two views that the superimposition of the structure was the main disadvantage. So this transorbital, it is delineating the joint with minimum superimposition. Now in this, how is the position of the film? Now we have seen in the other two that it was placed against the ear. Now in this, the film position, it is behind the patient's head at an angle of 45 degree to the sagittal plane. So now this is how the film is placed. So it is placed behind the head, and the patient, they are asked to hold this film. So the position of the patient is such that the sagittal plane is vertical and the tip of the head, it is downward about 10 degrees so that the canthomeatal line, it is horizontal, so that this is the canthus of the eye and this is the auditory meatus. So you have to see that this canthomeatal line, it should be horizontal, and because of that you ask the patient to tip the head down about 10 degrees. Now you can see over here, so you are tipping the head of the patient down so that your line, it gets horizontal. Now how is the projection of the central ray? Now in this, the X-ray tube, it is in front of the patient's head. Now you have seen in the other two, it was like on the contralateral side of your TMJ. So in this, now the film, it is behind the head, and your X-ray tube, it is in front of the patient's face, and it is directed to the joint of interest at an angle of plus 20 degrees to strike the cassette at right angle. So you have to see that now this angulation for this X-ray tube, it is plus 20 degree, and it is through the angle of interest. So it is through the TMJ of interest. So for example, if you want to see the left side, so you are going to place this X-ray tube head through the left side only. Now the point of the entry, it may be taken as the pupil of the same eye, asking the patient to look straight ahead through the middle canthus of the same eye. So how is the like point of entry which can be taken? So it can be through this pupil of the eye. Now what is the disadvantage for this? So if the patient, they cannot see, if they cannot open their mouth wide, so the areas of the joint which is articulating surface will be obscured because of the mutual superimposition. So this is again a disadvantage, but though we have seen that it creates minimum superimposition, but if the patient, they cannot open the mouth wide, so this is like you will see superimposition in all TMJ imaging techniques. So these are the three main plane imaging techniques of TMJ which are confined to this TMJ itself. So this was all about the three main imaging techniques of TMJ. I hope you found this video helpful. Thank you so much.